VRT. VRT is a specific form of physical therapy designed to promote habituation and compensation for deficits related to a wide variety of balance disorders. VRT is effective in improving the functional deficits and subjective symptoms resulting from unilateral and bilateral peripheral vestibular hypofunction, as well as from central balance disorders. By improving vestibular function and promoting mechanisms of central adaptation and compensation, VRT aims to do the following: improve balance, minimize falls, decrease subjective sensations of dizziness, improve stability during locomotion, improve neuromuscular coordination, decrease anxiety due to vestibular disorientation. There are three clear indications for vestibular rehabilitation referrals: specific interventions for benign paroxysmal positional vertigo, BPPV; general interventions for vestibular loss; unilateral loss, such as for vestibular neuritis or acoustic neuroma; bilateral loss, such as for gentamicin toxicity and related conditions. Empirical treatment for common situations where the diagnosis is unclear: post-traumatic vertigo, multifactorial disequilibrium of the elderly. Who are not likely to benefit from vestibular therapy? Individuals not likely to benefit from vestibular therapy include persons without a vestibular problem, for example, low blood pressure, medication reactions other than ototoxicity, migraine-associated vertigo, transient ischemic attacks, TIA, persons with fluctuating vestibular problems, perilymphatic fistula. These programs typically involve a three-pronged approach customized to the needs of the individual patient. 1. Habituation exercises designed to facilitate central nervous system compensation by extinguishing pathologic responses to head motion. 2. Postural control exercises. 3. General conditioning activities. VRT has been consistently shown to be an important part of the management of vestibular patients. Most studies show that patients improve on the order of 70% to 80%, but this does not mean to the point of being symptom-free. Covent and others found that 28% of their patients showed complete resolution of symptoms within 1 year, and 54% improved. Important note: please make sure it is safe to do these exercises. There should be nothing in the room that might get in the way or for you to trip over. You might find it helpful to have another person with you. These exercises were originally used in London in the 1950s to rehabilitate patients after labyrinthectomy operations. A labyrinthectomy is the deliberate destruction of the inner ear. It nearly always causes severe vertigo. You should aim to spend about an hour a day doing the exercises. Start with the simple, easy ones and work up to the more difficult. It is better to split the time up into short sessions of 5 to 10 minutes each. The more time and effort you put in, the quicker you will see some improvement. You will find that some of the exercises make you feel dizzy and sick. Don't worry, they are meant to do. That is how they work. By working through the vertigo, you are training the brain to compensate for the faulty signal from the defective inner ear. You should concentrate and spend extra time on any of the exercises you find difficult. There's no gain without pain. But don't overdo it to the extent that you vomit. That might put you off doing any more. You don't need to go to the gym for any of the eye, head, sitting or standing exercises, but you might prefer to do so for those involving moving about. To increase perceived gain, hold a card with lettering at arm's length. Move the card left and right across the visual field, tracking with eye movement and keeping the head still. Repeat the full cycle 20 to 30 times. Perform the test in the vertical and diagonal directions as well, increasing speed but being certain to keep the letters in focus. Progress from sitting to standing. To improve saccade latency, that is, the time from the presentation of the target to the commencement of saccadic eye movement, which leads to rapid fixation of the target, hold a card with lettering in each hand approximately 15 inches apart at arm's length. Keep the head still. Move the eyes back and forth from card to card, 1 second per card. Repeat 20 to 30 times for the complete cycle. This test can also be performed in the vertical and diagonal planes. Look up and down 20 times. Start slowly at first, then speed up. Look from one side to the other 20 times. Start slowly at first, then speed up. Hold one finger at arm's length. Focus on it. Move it slowly towards you and out again 20 times. With your eyes open, bend your head forwards, then backwards 20 times. Start slowly at first, then speed up. With your eyes open, turn your head from side to side 20 times. Start slowly at first, then speed up. As the dizziness improves, repeat the head exercises with your eyes closed. Shrug your shoulders 20 times. Turn your shoulders to the right and left 20 times. From the sitting position, bend down and pick up objects from the floor and sit back up again. Repeat 20 times. Move from sitting to standing up and back again with your eyes open 20 times. Repeat with eyes closed. Throw a small ball from one hand to the other above eye level 20 times. Throw the ball from hand to hand at knee level 20 times. Turn around 360 degrees on the spot, eyes open. Repeat with eyes closed. As vertigo lessens, speed up. Walk across the floor with your eyes open 20 times. Repeat with eyes closed. Walk up and down a slope with your eyes open 20 times. Repeat with eyes closed. Walk up and down steps 20 times with your eyes open. Repeat with eyes closed. Any game or exercise that involves stooping, turning, bending, stretching, and hand-eye coordination, for example, bowling, tennis, is good for improving your balance. Balance exercise. Start with the feet together. The patient may maintain balance by reaching out and touching the wall in front of them. Take the hands off the wall for progressively longer periods. Begin by taking one hand at a time off the wall, alternating hands. Sharpen the stance. Stand with the feet shoulder width apart, looking at a target on the wall. Narrow the base of support by sharpening the stance. Perform first with arms outstretched, then close to the body. Then fold it across the chest. Perform exercises with the room lights lowered and then with eyes closed. Progress to standing on foam or pillow and then to standing on one leg. Walking exercise 1. Begin by walking next to a wall with the hand held out for support and gradually increase the number of steps without support. Narrow the width of the gait and progress eventually to heel to toe walking. Walk with the head in motion, left and right, with increasing speed. Narrow the width of the gait. Move the head in the vertical direction as well. Practice turning when walking, first with large circles, then with gradually smaller turns in both directions. Three. Sit to stand. With two chairs approximately 10 feet apart, walk from one to the other. Upon reaching the first chair, sit without using the hands, and after 5 seconds, rise without using the hands. Go to the second chair, touch it, and with support, practice standing on one leg for 5 seconds. Repeat the entire cycle 10 times. Add head movements as the exercise progresses, increase walking speeds, and decrease width of gait. Vestibular rehabilitation is clearly worthwhile for disabling and refractory problems such as bilateral vestibular loss and easy to deal with problems such as BPPV. Home programs such as the Cawthon-Cooksey exercises are usually adequate for unilateral vestibular loss situations, such as vestibular neuritis. Vestibular rehabilitation therapy plays an important preventive role in reducing falls in at-risk elderly patients. VRT needs to be customized to the individual's impairments, and the exercises should be tailored according to each patient's rate of progression.